There is a story that once a lion and the donkey, they had an argument. Lion said that the color of the grass is green, and the donkey said it is not green. They had a lot of arguments. Finally, they went to the king, and the lion said, "King, that king, this donkey is saying that grass is not green, but I am saying that grass is green. Who is wrong and who is right?" The king said to the lion that you are wrong. He said, "Why, Majesty, why am I wrong?" He said, "You are wrong because you are arguing with a donkey." So this happens sometimes in life also, and it happened to me a few days back also. If somebody is like that, who is not able to understand the situation and the things, if you are going to argue with that person, it is useless. It is better to keep away from these type of people whom you cannot argue, or you cannot explain them, or you cannot make them understand. Hello, Namaste, Sat Sri Akal, good evening. Welcome to the SS Chandok Talk Show. I'm your host and moderator, SS Chandok. Today, we have very special guests, eminent guests from all the parts of the country where they are heading the schools, and also to CB, some people are heading the CBSE also from so many years, that we are going to share up a very good experience from them. Without wasting any time, I will introduce you to the very first eminent guest, that is Anuradha Handa ma'am. She is a principal of GD Goenka Public School, Gurugram. Ma'am is a principal of Gurugram and a committed educator with an experience then span over 30 years. A passionate teacher at heart, she carries a deep understanding of the teaching learning process and its impact on young minds. She's a postgraduate in physics from Delhi University with a professional degree in education. Ma'am started her journey as a postgraduate teacher with Modern School Vasant Vihar and also headed the physics department there. Having served the Premium Institute for 16 years and exhibiting excellent results, she moved into the role of vice principal at MIT International School, Noida, and later at APJ School, Saket. In the year 2010, ma'am came back to join MIT International School, Sector 46, Gurugram, as principal, and rendered her priceless contribution as an equally efficient administrator there. Carrying a belief that the purpose of education must be to nurture children into happy individuals who embody a scientific temper and a problem-solving approach to life, students under her tutelage grow into outstanding individuals, contributing positivity to society, convinced that education is for long and not just for living. GDGPS Sector 48 Gurugram, under her able leadership, is ranked among the best schools in Delhi NCR. Hailed as an influence education extremist of our country, ma'am features in the web series Education Extremist of India on ForbesIndia.com platform. Appointed as a resource person for CBSE, she is devoted to the capacity building of her fellow educators. She is also a proud recipient of Best Principals Award in the 5th EduLeaders Summit and Award 2020. I'll like to say sorry to all the eminent guests, because you all people are associated on national and international levels with all the societies, as well as you have received awards on national and international level. It will be very difficult for me to brief your resume, because it will take a day's time for each person to say that. You all are doing laurels to the education fraternity. Welcome, Anuradha ma'am. We will like to know about your education journey, ma'am.
So my journey as an educator, I think you've just given, first of all, a very good evening to everyone. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here on this platform. So I think you've already given a brief of my journey as an educator, essentially a teacher at heart, once a teacher, always a teacher, in love with my profession. And so 16 years having taught physics to children at Modern School, thought that, you know, shouldn't expand the horizon and move on and go ahead and share the experience and learn more and acquire other skills, and moved on to the position of a vice principal, and then from there to the position of a principal. And again, at GD Goenka, where I am, Sector 48, Gurugram, being a founder principal, these last over 9 years, close to 10 years, have been a beautiful experience of learning, growing, learning. I mean, it's been a great learning, because when you start a school, you know, I always used to hear that founder principals have, you know, it's a different experience. And now I can vouch for it because I have experienced it firsthand because I joined the school 9 months before the school came into existence. So I fondly call it my baby. And every student and every teacher who's a part of the school, you know, I have been kind of there and instrumental in having them on board with us and every program that is running beautifully with this team. So looking forward to, you know, now NEP and adding more values and skills as far as to the school and to the educational fraternity and collaborating with everyone, learning and growing. I think that's all I would like to say about my education.
Thank you so much, ma'am, and welcome. And it is for sure that when you come up with a startup school as a founder principal, the challenges are much more different challenges, although challenges all the time you have and you have to get through it. And it's different. And I am also had been the founder principal of State Anand Ram Jaipuria. So like you have there in Vasundhara also. That was a big challenge working over there. I was in Hamidpur branch. Thank you so much, ma'am, and welcome. Next, we have Yashika Bharadwaj, ma'am. She's the principal of RK Mangalam School, Ghaziabad. She has completed her schooling from England and her honors and masters in English from the Punjab University, Chandigarh. She secured the gold medal in her bachelor's as well as a master's degree in education. She has been in the field of education since 1985. A keen writer, she has authored several books in the educational field and has written several articles for journals such as Swagat and The Cavalier. An excellent orator, she has been an active member of debating societies in India and England and has compared events at the national level such as for national television and the Army Day Parade held in New Delhi. That's great, ma'am. She has held the esteemed position of the president of the Government College for Girls, Chandigarh, sports in charge of the hostel of GCG and president of the youth club of Raksha Bhavan. She has been a keen sports person, having represented her school in athletics and basketball and her colleagues in lawn tennis and swimming. She has been the winner of the Noida Squash Open for Women. She has been actively involved in community service, having conducted adult literacy drivers for women, computer literacy campaigns, and financial empowerment for women. She has been appreciated by the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation for her efforts in environment education. An innovative traveler, she has traveled vastly, not only in India, but across the world. And at the very same time, again, ma'am has received so many awards, associated with so many associations. We welcome you, ma'am. And coming to know that you have done your, education, basic education from England, then you have moved to Punjab, and then you have moved over at Delhi and Delhi NCR. So how did it came that maybe your father or your husband was into job where he had two transferable jobs he had? Please let us know about this.
Well, a very warm good evening to everyone on the panel. And thank you, Mr. Chandok, for having me with you. And I head the K.R. Mangalam World School in Vaishali currently. And your question as to whether it was my husband and his job that took me to school in England, the answer is no, I wasn't child married. It was my father who was in the Defence Forces, and he was posted there in the UK for a period of 4 years. So I had the opportunity to finish my school from grade almost 9 to 12 over there, and then came back to Chandigarh to do my English honours there.
That's great, ma'am. And you had been a very good athletic, and so many games you had been over there, ma'am. So you had been in college, and how do you promote that in your school, ma'am?
Well, you promote it by example, and I may be the principal of a school, but that doesn't mean that I am too old to play any game. So for an hour in the morning and in the hour in the evening, I still am very much into physical fitness. And I think it is greatly contributory to making me the person that I am. And it was just a couple of years ago that I won the Noida Squash Open. So it's never really too late for you to pursue a sport or be involved with physical fitness. And ours is a Fit India certified school. And we try to seize every opportunity that we can to ensure that not just the students, but the staff and the parents are also getting involved in play. So even in this virtual medium too, we have had fitness, physical fitness as one of the key goals, and have been doing small programs by which the students can be in touch with the fun side of it.
Absolutely, ma'am. Because when the head of the institution is involved there physically also into the ground with the students. So that motivates the students as well as the staff, also teachers also. That's great, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am. We are very proud to be here.
Thank you.
Then we have Anuradha Mehta, ma'am. She's the principal of Red Roses Public School, Delhi. Anuradha ma'am is PhD in education, MA in economics, and MA in education also. She has 32 years of experience in the field of education. Took command of the school as principal from 1st November 2002. She was awarded as CBSE Teachers Award 2015, Delhi State Teacher Award 2013, Savitribai Phule Award, and so many awards, ma'am, she has received. She has presented 20 and more papers, articles on many diverse topics like high achieving schools, teaching and learning strategies, green environment, gender sensitization, reimagining education in post-pandemic, blending learning in the future education, etc., which are published in national and international journals and newspapers. She has been speaker in many webinars like Magic of Gratitude and many more. She took many community initiatives for social work in collaboration with the Rotary Club of New Delhi and many NGOs like HelpAge India, Goonj, Aron, and Uday Foundation. She has visited countries like China, USA, Australia, Finland, Sweden, and Norway, and Japan for attending the international conferences of principals from India to learn the finest education system of the world. Welcome, ma'am. We welcome you all. But we will here like to know that what type of NGOs you are working and which is the most important NGO, what's the most important work you are doing for the society?
See, recently we had joined Uday Foundation, and before that we were having different NGOs. First of all, good evening to all esteemed panelists. It's wonderful to see everyone smiling. And Neha ma'am, greetings to you, because I've met you. I don't know you remember or not in CBSE workshops and all. And it's been a long journey, and it's been quite some time now. And NGO is a part of what we are doing, because in PTA, when we organize our PTA meetings and all, we always see to it that we have one NGO parent with us. That is very, very important, because they are the ones who are really dealing with other parents and the students and teaching them street plays and other very good things what our parents are also doing. So we are part of one of the parents who is doing a great job in this NGO. So we are into it and doing other good, I think, work for Rotary Club, like blood donation camps and so many other medical camps. We organize for our residents, nearby residents, and it's a free whole day camp, which we organize nearly every year, because last 2 years we were not doing, but we keep organizing and quite popular with the residents, so hardly have any fights.
That's great, ma'am. That's great, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am. Welcome. Next, we have Neha Sharma, ma'am. She's the principal of GD Koenka Public School, Ghaziabad. Ma'am is MA in English, MEd specialization in special education and education technology. She is MA in psychology pursuing, PhD thesis submitted for award, PDC in multiple intelligence in primary and secondary classes from MII Singapore, IBDPC certificate from IBO, that is International Baccalaureate Organization, Geneva. Currently assignment is she's the principal of GD Goenka Public School, Ghaziabad, Rajnagar extension. And her previous assignment, she had worked with as a principal in DPS Gwalior, worked in government sector for 6+ years, as ma'am told, and held the post of deputy secretary and head CBSE Center for Excellence Delhi Training Unit, head CBSE Center for Excellence Panchkula. That's great, ma'am. Assistant teacher, assistant director general at National Skill Development Agency, NSDA, MSDE, GOL, and deputy director exam and reforms administration, UDAN, CBSE principal headmistress role at GD Goenka Public School, Delhi East, New Delhi, and MIT International School, Vasundhara Sector 6. Ma'am, you have done everything on this side of as a principal and that side also. That means we have to salute you, because everywhere you had been. We would like to know from you, Neha ma'am, that how come, I mean, was this that you were in this government sector, that is deputy secretary and head of CBSE first, then you came as a principal, or in between you went there, and how come this change went into in your life? Ma'am, over to you, please.
I think this is one question which I've been asked so many times, that I have it on my tips, that how to start and what to tell and how to close it. So of course,
ma'am, I had to ask, because just few minutes back I got a scolding for that. Please, please carry on.
Nice, sir. It was not a scolding, and if you felt it like a scolding, my apologies. It was just that.
I'm just joking, you know, ma'am. I'm just joking.
Sir, what happens is that there are some organizations, some places which are very close to your heart, and for very obvious reasons. And you know, you get defensive when you hear anything which you feel like, oh my God, it's like, you know, listening something against your family. So if you felt like
ma'am,
that,
ma'am, we are also your family, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Had been the guardian there for 6 years, and of course, we were your family, ma'am. That was your family, but you are our guardian.
Okay.
All so the schools were your guardian.
Nice, sir. I mean, let's take it further. So as Yashika ma'am rightly said that, you know, once a teacher, always a teacher thing. I think that was the reason why I went and came out of CBSE. I have been a teacher for longish period of my professional journey. And when I was heading, I think me and Anuradha ma'am, we started the school at the same time, somewhere in 2010 only. And I was the founder principal of GD Goenka Karkaduma, East Delhi branch. After, you know, I was there for almost 2 years when this direct recruitment opening came up at CBSE. I applied, appeared for written, appeared for interview and got selected for the post of Deputy Director, Exams and Reforms. And it was those CC times. So I was part of the core team that brought in CC, and my job at that point was actually to put CC in place and in order. So I stayed there for 6 years, and as we all will believe, we just have one life. So in that 6 years of tenure, it was a great learning journey. I learned a lot of things which I think otherwise possibly just wouldn't have happened. And then I realized that, you know, schools are the places which make me feel happier. It's not this. Kindly do not take it that I was not happy at CBSE. I was extremely happy and was definitely glad contributing in my smallest, teeniest ways. But schools, you know, there's something about schools. It kind of attracts you. It has got a charisma which makes you feel lively, which cannot take away that smile from your face. And I think it was that thing that made me take a call that fine, instead of staying there till 60, I better hang my boots and get back to the place which in this one life I always would have loved, and I mean the place where I belong. So this is the long story cut short.
That's great, man, because this story has been so different that everybody might be asking you how you went there and you again came back. And the thing is, you feel so good. You're absolutely right, ma'am. Because the feeling you have when you come into the school, it is a saying, you don't go above the age of 18 if you're in a school. After 18, your age stops. You are never up because you are with the age group of 3 to 18. And you feel that child in you always remains when you are inside the school. That is why you feel very good with them. That is for sure. Especially for the very small ones, kids one. And we are feeling so great when the pre-primaries or the primary students are coming. So cute little babies, they are coming to the school. Whatever problems you are facing, whatever headache is there, everything goes away when you see to them. And that is the reason why we feel very good at our schools. And we are happy that the schools have reopened. Welcome, ma'am. And we are very happy and very pleased that you are over here. Then we have Hardeep Kaur, ma'am. She's the principal of Cambridge School, Ghaziabad. She's the principal and has 42 years of experience in the field of education. She holds a master's degree in commerce from Delhi University with specialization in finance. She's a dynamic, proactive, and a passionate educationist and has been involved in activities relating to the development of progressive curriculum and its implementation. Her vision is to build a sense of community and trust between children, parents, and teachers by providing a conducive environment and translating the school vision into reality. Welcome, Hardeep, ma'am. And we also had been knowing you as you are in Indirapuram. That you have told over here, ma'am, that you are involved in activities relating to development of progressive curriculum and implementation. How you're doing this in your school or otherwise?
Good evening, everyone. And thank you, Mr. Chandok, for having me here. I mean, it's a privilege to be able to discuss pertinent issues here with all of you. I have been involved with this progressive curriculum in our school. I mean, we all are bound by a syllabus which has been provided to us by the CBSE, the NCERT books. That's there, that curriculum has to be transacted. But beyond that, what we are looking for is development of the personality of the child. You know, the leadership qualities is something which, I endeavor to bring out in the children. So what we do is we bring together the academic and co-curricular activities, and we try and blend it together so that the children get the opportunity that is required, and more so like life skills, the skills that they would require when they move out of the school, the protected walls of the school, and go to the college and to their offices. So for that, what we do is we give a lot of responsibility to the children, and we have embedded some tests into our system, into our curriculum. So, there are these tests with the children organized. I mean, absolutely, the entire work is done by the children. So they go on and they contact various schools and they get participation right from, the scratch to the final awards. Everything is being done by them. So now, by doing this, they develop a lot of skills which are, very important for them, like leadership, communication, organizing, management. So all these things are embedded into the system, and the children are exposed to this, which makes them more confident when they move out of the school. And, it helps them when they reach their colleges. And, I'm very proud to say that most of our children, they find their place in their college societies and their clubs, and they're the organizers there. And then they come back to say that, thank you for giving that platform to us, which helped us develop our leadership and all these skills, and which is helping us today. So, I'm happy and proud to be able to do this for our children.
That's great, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am. And Anipi also says that it's bringing up bunches of happiness for the children. And it is going to be and this is the best thing the government has done, that Anipi is coming, where the children will be able to choose everything according to their own, their interests, it will be, and they'll do the best. And there will be a vast difference of education system now, which the government has done. Thanks to the government for all this positivity. Welcome, ma'am. Then we have Mr. Mayank Jain. He's the youngest of us. He I met him. He has obtained a degree of BTech from one of the most prestigious colleges in India, DCE. While in college, he founded a platform called Easy Schooling that would go to become the largest admission platform in Delhi NCR. He has helped 10,000 plus parents in their admissions journey through his Zoom sessions. He also visited 1,000 plus schools across India and consulted and guided them on how to boost admissions. He knows the ins and outs of the field like no one else. When I met Mr. Mayank, we're talking about him, I just came to know that he has started up a very new thing. Like there's a platform, he has a website where the schools get listed and the parents, they don't have to move to the schools and to 4 to 5 schools to get their child admitted. And it takes around 10 to 15 days to move the schools. So when he told me about his concept, so it came in my mind that it used to happen earlier, that we used to send our people from the office, okay, go to the railway station and get our tickets collected. Then we used to have the mediators that is the agents. Now we can get it done from the mobile itself. Again, when we are talking about shopping and everything, it is online. So because we are in the industry from 25 or 20 years or 30 years plus, we are not into that technology, right? 100% into technology right now. So when he told about this, that we are having a platform where the schools are collaborated and the parents, they do the counseling sessions with their parents. The main thing is that the parents have the misconcept about the schools that are, like we had in the starting of this pandemic also, okay, that these people are here to, schools are here to mint money. कुछ पढ़ाना नहीं है ऑनलाइन में क्या पढ़ाई होती है पैसे किस देने के व्हाई डू शुड वी पे द फीसेस एंड ऑल सो हियर द मिसकंसेप्ट्स ऑफ द पेरेंट्स द बेस्ट थिंग दे आर डूइंग इज मे बी दिस और व्हाट आई केम टू नो अबाउट हिम मे बी देर आर मोर प्लेटफॉर्म्स आल्सो सो व्हेन आई केम टू हिम आई मेट हिम टू आस्क हिम एंड हैड अ डेप्थ ऑफ दैट आई वट एवर हिज ऑलरेडी द स्कूल्स आर एसोसिएटेड आई हैड वर्क विद 2-3-4 पीपल आल्सो समटाइम्स इट हैपेंड व्हेन वी आर टेकिंग द सेशन द ऑलरेडी द प्रिंसिपल हु इज ओवर देयर she or our school is already associated with a school like GEMS also international. Many other schools are associated. So the best thing I came to know is that this is the future. As we know that whatever used to happen earlier, when 30 years back, when the mobiles were a very new thing, when Dhirubhai Ambani brought up the mobiles, that small mobiles in 500 rupees. So my saying was that ek time aayega jab wo peanut wale ke bhi, bhonkli wale ke bhi, jab ghanti bajegi, bhonkli hatayega aur wo mobile nikalega. Talking this thing now is a stupid thing. I'm talking a stupid thing. But at that time, it was just like, it will happen like this. So nothing is impossible. Now the trend will be like, I also feel when I met with him and I requested him to come over to our show also and tell us what actually is going on over there in the market, that how are the schools, how are you bridging up the gap between the parents and the schools? Because a lot of disinformation is there. We had seen that some schools are over there, not all, some schools are there on their website. They show a lot of things which are not there in the school. They show up so many good pictures from the internet that we are having all these facilities. When the parent is getting admitted and getting into the school, they're not getting that. Because of these type of schools, the schools like us, they also get up the same reputation. So how do you do that? How do they do it like this? In the later part of the session, we'll talk to him. Welcome, Mr. Mayank, and would you like to say something about yourself?
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, everybody. Good evening, all of you from my side. So whatever I am today, whatever I am running the company today is because of all of you, because you are the leaders who create us. And because of teachers like you, leaders like you, we are able to create something for the future and create jobs, especially. So I was invited with some Delhi government schools for giving a talk to those entrepreneurship, like 11th, 12th grade students. So I am so honored that teachers ki wajah se hi hum yahan pe hote hain. And I was talking to my advisor, Sonal Agarwal Wali. She was telling me Vedant, like GD Goenka Gurugram mein, he's studying, he's a skating champion over there. So I was so surprised that this world is so small that you meet people and you are so connected with each other. And I was so impressed by when I met that child. So he was so talented and I think he's a star performer of your school, Anuradha ma'am. So that's it. So why I started up with Easy Schooling was because net pe bahut zyada misinformation hai and parents bahut zyada confused rehte ki kaun se school mein admission lena chahiye, and Sharma ji ke ladke ne school mein karaya to hum bhi school mein karayenge admission. Wo wala ek psychology carry forward hota hai. So that's why we created with this portal to guide parents in choosing the right school for their child. There is no best school as such, but we should help parents in choosing the right school and then they can apply through our portal. So around lakhs of parents are visiting us and hundreds of schools are associated with us. So we are able to do a bit. And jaise Neha ma'am ne bola ki school se something that attracts us, like I carry the same thing. So from like second year of my college or first year of my college, when I was a like a 12th grade pass out kid, I am visiting schools. So schools se nikalne ke baad bhi, college mein jaane ke baad bhi, I was visiting schools. So that's something that I am very, very deeply connected with schools and want to do something for this ecosystem.
That's great. And frankly speaking, ma'am, when I met him, so I thought that he's my ex-student of my school. He's so small. I think he's 24, you are, sir. Mayank, you are 24.
24.
And he left his parents' business and ancestral business. And he said that IIT came into my mind. His things and thoughts were so good that I told him to, you just come to our show, tell us about yourself. So he told me that I have my parents' business, but I didn't join that. It came into my mind when I was doing my education, my engineering. And I started this, as he told us now also, that while in the college also, I started visiting the schools. So you have brought up a new concept. And what I felt actually, ma'am, that this is a new concept which is going to become old afterwards. After 4 or 5 years, I suppose, all pan India, no parent will be going to the school to take admissions, because the past experience says the same thing. No parent will be going to school. Most of the parents will be going on the internet. Now also we see that all the off shoppings, everything is happening on the mobiles only. Thank you so much. Welcome, ma'am. My welcome. Let's move to the next part, ma'am. We'll come up to a small discussion of the questions. I cannot say I want to ask questions. I'm small enough. Although I'll ask questions from everyone. Anuradha Honda, ma'am, we'll ask you because you're on the first. What are the challenges faced by schools, especially during COVID-19? We had a lot of challenges, especially parents. We in Delhi and Delhi NCR also, we had seen so many videos that the parents had been protesting and everything had been happening. So what were the challenges according to which were being faced by the schools during COVID-19?
think challenges are a constant in life. Life is always, and it's always when we are challenged, is that when we work to our capacity. And I must say that COVID has really enhanced our capacity, because every day, right from the time, you know, let's say March of 2020 to now the October of 2021, every day we come across something which seems like a challenge, and then we all come together, put our heads together and try and find a solution to it. So sure enough that in comparison to a regular day-to-day working that we have, these 18, 19 months have challenged us in every possible way, because the working just got reversed. You see, if we look at the COVID time, it had really decentralized everything in a school setup where everything comes to the front desk, goes through the leadership to the teachers, to the students, to the parents. Now here we were where, you know, the teachers were literally at the home of the parents virtually, and that connect started from there. So the first challenge that probably we faced was how to bring everyone together, you know, so that we work like an organization and we do not fall into an individualistic kind of a working. So obviously starting with the virtual classes, but then moving on to making sure that we are all strongly connected, and that connection and that culture that we have, because every school has a certain culture and a way of working and a way of interacting, way of sharing, that should not get compromised, and that uniqueness has to be maintained. Making sure that the children carry that discipline, they attend classes, the cameras are on, the teachers, you know, the timing of the teachers is respected. We know that when we got into this COVID time, so there was, you know, like Neha ma'am was saying, that a 24/7 kind of a working at CBSE. I think we all got into that in the COVID time, and we totally relate to it and understand, because our meetings used to be happening even, let's say, at 11 o'clock at night, because every day we were preparing for the next day, because there was so much uncertainty, which still prevails to some extent as we are transiting from an online to a hybrid and an offline model. And so taking care of each of those things, and then to take the parents along, because earlier the information would go through the students to the parents, and now here the parents were sitting along with the children. So that also in itself, because for a teacher, you know, to ensure that that dignity of interaction between a student and the teacher and the parent is maintained, and it doesn't become a kind of an interference. So there were a lot of aspects which have challenged us, and we've just gone on to find their solutions. Like one solution, for example, you know, when initially for a month everything was good, and suddenly we saw that the energy of the children was dipping in classes, because initially they were excited that, okay, I can see my teacher online and I can study. But then sitting in front of a screen, and that was not something that could go on for very long. So I remember, you know, in the month of May last year, I had to actually call my activity teachers and tell them, go and intrude into classes, jao aur hangama karo classes mein, because that's what will bring the energy back. You know, let it be a surprise and let the children feel ki kya ho raha hai. And then in order to get the teachers' timelines to be defined, so we went into, when we went, we you know, we were using, we've been using G Suite and Google Classroom. So in July of 2020, I started the systems of having the staff rooms for teachers, so that we stayed locked in and there is that togetherness. You know, otherwise there was a lot of sense of loss ki har kisi ko phone pe baat karo, because either the teacher is in a class, but you can't go and talk to the teacher there. So how do you create that connection which was going missing? And we couldn't afford to miss the connection for a long time. So we said, okay, let's have, you know, staff rooms where teachers are locked in and there is discussion, because we all want to, man is a social animal, we want interactions, we want to share our problems, you know, and we've all been going through uncertainty, and so that's what we did. Then again, to enhance the participation of children, we started with a concept called LEAP, which is like, you know, have the children divided into groups, engage them, use more of applications. Then again, in the month around Diwali, we felt that the interest is kind of dipping. So I said, stop everything for a week and let's have an R3 week, which is like you reflect, you reboot, you refresh. Taking parents along, having a lot of Google Meets, explaining them the concepts, because, you know, very soon they would go on to the other side. So to bring them along, you see, it's very easy to kind of say that if anyone is getting into negativity, we do not have to allow that negativity to grow. We have to continue to make efforts as educators and as schools to take people along. Because confrontation will never give you any result. So taking people along, I feel, has been the biggest challenge. And that influence that you are able to cause when the children are in school, when the teachers are in school, you making that as a very conducive system, and the information going out to the parents in a systematic and structured manner, that is something which probably was challenged the most in this time. And the influence of other, whatever is happening in the country, it coming on and all of us being treated as common in terms of that problem. So those have been the challenges. And then in the month of Jan, Feb, March, when we thought that we were coming back to normal, we were happy to have children in school, we were able to have at least those offline pre-board examinations, we were conducting PTMs also. And while we were getting ready to go, let's say, east, we saw the sun rising of hope. Suddenly that second wave came in April and we had to take a U-turn. So that was most challenging, so to say. And now, coming back to school, it was being shared while Neha said that, they've been very, very fortunate that all children are coming to school. And I'm sure, there is a lot of attraction which brings them on. But definitely it is a challenge to have children in school and to be able to run a hybrid model, to be able to have that half capacity in a classroom and manage your resources well, to have reliable assessments of children, to get them back into discipline, to tell them what is right and all those issues that we are having with respect to the mental health. So I think these are the challenges which we've all had. But the good thing is that we are coming together always, whether on a platform like this or in our sahodayas or within our school with little teams, and coming together to find the solution. So that is the positive side of what we have gone through. I think that's
great, ma'am. That's great, ma'am. You are absolutely right. So many challenges we had to face during the pandemic. Even the teachers were not knowing that how to teach on online, because that was very new for. Because when you are talking about any topic, we are talking about all the schools pan India. It's not about my or your school only. We are talking about all the schools. But that was a very big challenge. Somebody a few days back on media asked me, social media asked me, that when he saw this poster of the principals, he said, what are these principals doing? So the whatever quotation I said in the beginning, it happens there only didn't argue. What everything stopped, but the education did not stop. This is the best thing what we had done. We have proved in this 1.5 year. And rest while, whoever so is there, there's a doctor, there's an engineer, or whoever is there, there's just because of the teachers. So you don't have to tell that what we have done for the society, every one of the leaders. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for your answer. Yashika, ma'am, will you like to add up into this, the challenges?
I think Anuradha has covered it very well. And when you asked about the challenges faced by schools during the COVID time, the school, the child is at the centroid of a triangle, and the corners or the vertices being made up of the school, the community, and the parents. So this pandemic, in one way, has actually vilified something that I've always maintained, that no matter how advanced we get as a society, there are two professions that we will always require. One being the doctors, and two being the teachers. And you can have n number of houses built which could be surplus or deficit or whatever. But these two professions, children will be born, they need to be educated, and people will fall sick and they will need to go to hospitals. During this COVID period, if you look at it from the school's perspective, the three categories that were affected were the three stakeholders. But there was a fourth factor as well, which was the support staff of the school. And they too were affected greatly by the schools getting into an online or a lockdown mode. As far as the children are concerned, I think one great positive that has come of this pandemic is that it has created willing learners. Now, while you are sitting in front of a camera and talking to people, as I'm speaking with you, I can see the six of you or seven of us on the screen. But you can see just the one person if you're looking or zoomed in or focused in on the person speaking. Similarly, whether you're using a Google platform or you're using MS Teams or whatever medium that you're using, a child coming in front of a TV screen is coming there for two reasons. One is to escape the fear psychosis, the drudgery, or the apprehensions that the entire family is facing at home. And the second is because he wants to learn. He wants to see his friends. He wants to see his teachers. So here you've got fertile soil in which to sow. So it's actually become what used to be 10 years ago in Kota that you had 250 to 300 people in a class and big screens were put up and the lecturer took a lecture and coaching classes were given, which ended up being one-to-one. Here, despite the fact that you are speaking in a virtual mode, it is a one-to-one interconnect between the teacher who's presenting and the student who's there. A huge challenge that has come has also been for the parents. I've been a part of the CBSE telecounseling team for over two decades now. And the parents do have access to your numbers as principals as well. And the number of counseling sessions that we've had to had for the parents also has increased phenomenally. Because suddenly when you're two adult individuals leading independent lives and the entire family and more so in joint family scenarios has been put together in one home, each using a gadget or a gizmo or a device to be able to do their work, you suddenly find there's a tremendous amount of stress that has increased in the family. As far as the teachers are concerned, it was a welcome challenge. As principals, we've been asking teachers to adopt technology for a very, very long time. And here suddenly it was thrust upon us. And it was one thing simply sitting in front of a camera, picking up a notebook or a book and reading it and teaching it, which was probably the most boring way to do it. And then you saw teachers world over graduate from that to the PowerPoint presentations. And suddenly now we're at a stage where the number of free apps that are available online in the digital world to enhance the teaching learning process are enormous. In fact, we conducted webinars for over 300 teachers on how to use online teaching tools efficiently and online teaching tools that were free. And in order to conduct that webinar, I first had to educate myself and shortlist out of 300, come down to about 70, and then form a core team and then show it to the teachers how it can be enhanced. The beauty of it was that once the teacher got to know the one app and seen how efficiently she could use it and seen the efficacy of using it the same as far as the students are concerned, the teacher herself went on to explore and the students themselves went on to explore. And the classroom now is actually a happy place. And even if I think we had 100% vaccination in our country, the students have gotten used to this face-to-face, online face-to-face teaching, not the actual face-to-face teaching. And it would require a sea change and a huge motivation to be bringing those children back, because now this generation, which is born into technology, is so used to technology that they need the teacher there as an assist. An indispensable factor here is the teacher. So it's affected everybody across the board, across the school. But I'm very glad to say that everyone has risen to the occasion and has come out of it richer as far as experience and a contribution is concerned.
That's great, Pam. And the only positivity of COVID-19 is that technology has come into being. I came across a video through a person also that there was a government teacher in a village. She had a will to teach the students. She went into the community hall there in the village, took a projector and called out the students, and with a social distancing, she taught there. So where there is a will, there's a way. And it was a very big challenge at the starting that how the things had to be taken care of, especially it was with the teachers, because the teachers had to deal with the students directly at many places. I also had taken so many webinars and you know, this discussions or you know, this thing with teachers pan India from many states, which were from outer skirts. They were not knowing that they were where there were problems of internet connectivity also. They didn't had connectivity also, and they said, how can we go online? How can they teach through at least through WhatsApp also? It had, we didn't knew anything. We don't have any facilities. We don't have any money, the funds, how can we do so? It was a very big challenge, of course, in Pan India, because India is an agriculture country and there are more than 550 villages. We are in the cities. In cities, there were no problem. We are talking about NEP, so many things. Already we big schools are doing NEP about, but about the schools, the government schools especially, all over India, or the village schools or the state schools, what are they going to do? That is the most important thing. Thank you so much, Yashika ma'am. Thank you. Then we'll come up to Anuradha ma'am, Anuradha Mehta ma'am. What were the challenges faced by the administrators, especially the principals, when online teaching had to be done? That is with the teachers who were totally unaware of the method of online teaching. Please let us know, ma'am.
Thank you so much. And I think both of them have fantastically explained all these things. We all know that COVID stuck us without a warning and significantly impacted various things globally, teaching being worst hit among all. So it was also redefined the role of a teacher to a facilitator and now as a coach to articulate a vision in a virtual setting. This was very important. It was not easy for teachers to accept this change, since they were accustomed to the conventional method of teaching. They thought that it was injustice to expect them to become technocrats within no time. So giving trainings and workshops to teachers in a short span to equip and familiarize them with the platform that they were going to use for online learning, that was a challenge for the administrators. But their eagerness resulted in a spat on online classes for learners of every level, ranging from scholastic subjects to co-scholastic areas such as fine and performing arts and mental wellness and physical fitness. So they were ready with implementation plan in response to trying times for quality, flexibility, and sustainable learning options. So the first and foremost thing was professional development of the teachers in the e-learning environment. It was, it's not the case that they were completely ignorant about the technology. As we all know that most of our teachers were teaching on smart boards, but conducting online classes, that was something they had not imagined. And many of them considered it as an unwanted intrusion in students' homes and of course, vice versa. And there was another set of teachers who expressed their anxiety of being judged by the parents and other family members of their students. So at this time, all the administrators, I think we all decided to lead by example. So there, we all conducted staff meetings on virtual platforms, supported the teachers by providing them technical support through IT department of the school. And we all principals also conducted virtual meetings with parents in which they were told about the internet etiquettes to be followed by them and the students. And they also provided emotional support to the teachers by one-on-one interactions, which I had done last year with my teachers, that I had one-on-one interaction, which each and every teachers of my 90 staff members and where teachers were encouraged to share their problems that they might be facing during this pandemic. So this boosted the morale of those teachers who identified several barriers that affect online teaching in home environment. And soon they were trying different platforms from Google Meet to Zoom to WebEx and MS Teams. So as we all know that technology is one thread that binds all the stakeholders together. So technologically a sound teacher can help students even remotely. And I think thus they had become the reason for a change in the life of a student. So thus I think we can say that smart and technical admins were able to engage the teachers in online mode without much difficulty with the help of their resourcefulness and convincing ability.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. We'll come up to Neha Sharma, ma'am. Neha, ma'am, you are dealing with your school. I think many schools might be associated with you from whom you might be counseling. So how did you did in your school and how did you help the other schools also with this stress, like ma'am, another ma'am told, okay, that teaching on a board, on a smart board and teaching online classes was something very different. So how did you switch over your teachers, their mental ability from this to that?
So, you know, something that I would like to touch upon here is that the challenge was not just about going digital. It was also about maintaining your sensibilities as teachers while you were playing the roles of mama and papa and you know, uncle, aunt, I mean, the entire family. It was not just this, that the teachers were becoming part of the students' family. Their whole family was becoming part of their school. And it is really challenging that you as a mother are at home and you have to take care. You know, the expectations from mothers are way higher. I mean, I'm sorry to say, and nothing to be taken as a gender bias. But the reality is that if the mother is at home and the father is also at home, the child will be first reaching out to the mother for a lot of things. And imagine the plight of a mother who is also a teacher. She has to balance out between, you know, the home related things, responsibilities, and then, of course, maintaining things, you know, as her professional responsibility also. So this was also coming up as a challenge besides the digital challenges that we all acknowledge really, really strongly. Also, you know, this was a time we all lost someone close. I mean, loss became such a common thing that, you know, there was a point when we started feeling anything about loss. There was a period where we heard a news and we're like, acha, okay, he also, she also. And that was the only reaction. You know, the tears were somehow totally, they just dried out. So it was faced by everybody and even the teachers. And for all these challenges, all that we could do, I could do, was that to connect personally and, you know, give them that shoulder, give them that feel that, okay, come what may, whatever be the things, we are together. I mean, whatever little we can do to make things comfortable for you, be it allowing them to kind of, you know, switch off their camera for some time, stay only on voice mode if they are not feeling very, very healthy mentally, or just allowing them not to take class, putting someone else as substitute teacher for their class, or, you know, just a call once in a while to check, okay, are you okay? Besides the official groups, besides the official connect, we also did a lot of chit-chat sessions. As Anuradha ma'am said that, you know, she created staff rooms. So on similar manners, we did walk while your talk. So we felt that health is taking a back seat because we all are confined. So we started a walk and talk session at 8:30 sharp. Finished all your school home related work, and we'll be discussing whatever we have to plan for next day over a call, wherein you go to whichever corner of your house, you can take some steps and walk. Or we even experimented that 8 mode of walking, wherein in smaller spaces, you can walk in the formation of 8 and you know, you can still manage to get some exercise, because somewhere it was required that we all feel positive and okay about whatever is happening around us, because the mental health of the teacher was to be taken care of so that the mental health of students and the families in turn can also be regularized, can also be supported. So, I mean, the only thing that worked, at least for me, was empathy and that connect, and making them feel that fair enough, I may be a principal, but not always. I am one amongst you, and please reach out to me whenever you feel you need somebody to just listen. So that was what we tried to do.
That's great, ma'am. That is, and it's not a, it's a team, it's a family. That is a school family we are having. As a guardian, as an elder, we have to take care of all the teachers. That's great, ma'am. And that is the greatness you are over here, and into all the things which we have not reached, will not be able to reach also. That's great, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am. Thank you. Next, we will come up to Hardeep for ma'am. Ma'am, we have seen that so many things have come into, online. Online shopping has come, online advertisement has come, many things have come. Do you agree it should be like that? It should have been like manually only we were going to the shops or the outlets or the malls we were buying. It is better, it was better, or this is better. We were going for the school advertisement, like in the newspapers or in the, for the hoardings all over the city or the locality, or we should go up with this advertisement going up to the internet and passing it out to all the places. What do you feel?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chanduk, for this question. I feel online is here and it is here to stay. You know? So online processing has existed in India for quite some time, say a decade or so. But it has become prominent in recent days, especially during this pandemic. Now, if you take a look at the scenario in urban areas or type 2 cities, we find that irrespective of the socioeconomic strata, consumers are using online mode for buying and selling. You know, it's convenient. It gives you many options to compare and to choose. And the range of products is not only about the everyday items, essentials or medicines, but also like insurance policies, even real estate. You know, I was looking for a house and I used to see all these vlogs where, the property dealers and the builders, they make videos of their houses. So I don't need to go there and see the houses physically. It's so difficult. But sitting at the comfort of my house, I can, see all those, visit all those places. So that's, it's very convenient. And also not to forget that the target customers online, the age begins at zero. I mean, to say that you have options for newborn babies, and then there is no upper age limit for the products that we have online. And, but we must look at situation in remote areas as well. So there's no denying the fact that internet facilities, and the allied infrastructure, it has made way into the villages as well. But thousands haven't reaped the benefits of these facilities yet. You know, there is a digital divide. We have people still going to the neighborhood markets, the shops. They find it convenient, they find it easy, because delivery to remote areas is costly, it takes time. So they prefer the grocery wala next door, and also they have that credit system that works with them. So when we talk of shopping and advertising, yes, internet has moved way ahead. There's a lot of shopping that goes online. Majorly the thrust would have been the forced lockdown. If I look at it my way, I started getting all vegetables during that lockdown at home. And even after the lockdown was lifted, I continue to do it. Now also I find it so convenient. I just, give a call to that person and he'll send all the vegetables. So people in urban areas, yes, I would say 70% to my estimate, it's all online now. But we must consider the areas which do not have these facilities and people who don't have access to these facilities. while talking of, you know, this is about shopping, it's about advertisement, but talking of education, education also has now, you know, as we were talking, it has gone online. But again, there's a divide. Even in villages, we see, you know, there was some picture on the internet where a teacher was on top of the tree trying to get some signal to teach his children, right? So, you know, we do think that it's a good way to reach out to the masses. If the infrastructure is strengthened, it has huge potential. Online, you know, it will bring about accessibility, equality of opportunity, I would say. You know, you can have access to the best of the of education.
But ma'am, we have to have positivity over here, because if you are saying about the villages, mobiles have reached there, which where we were not thinking over mobiles will be, because connectivity is there, that is mobile is there. But because this is spreading, it cannot come over the whole country once in a time. When it has to spread, if you're talking about an EP, say, when an EP will come, it will come up with some drawbacks also. But the positivity of the NEP is much more than the drawbacks. If you are saying any subject can be taken by any child, how the subjects will be managed, that is not a challenge. The thing is what positivity it is bringing. That so many things will be coming that the children will be able to opt their own subjects, their interests, and their mental level, what critical thinking, what we say, that critical thinking will be 100% in our country. Because rote learning is still existing. I mean, I think 80 to 90% rote learning is existing till now. More than that, even in the big schools also. So positivity is there, ma'am, that because these things, but if in cities also people go for, you know, physical shopping also. When you're returning something, they don't return it. Or they say, we won't return the money, okay. We will give something in out of that. So you are not getting a choice what to take. You are tied over there. But when you come up to these apps, what do they do? Instantly, they will return your money within an hour. So after sales service. So the thing is that people don't have time, they have money. And when they are getting after sales response, it may be in the form of the goods we are buying, or if we are talking about education, we are reaching everywhere. If the advertisement is done, we are talking about, say, about, basically we are talking about education only. When we are talking about this, so here the thing is that when we are talking about, you know, heavy, I mean, expenses done on the advertisement in the newspapers, in the local newspapers and the hoardings, instead, when we are going up with the e-advertisement, I feel that it is economical also, and you reach worldwide. Everybody comes to know, okay, in your city, that school is there. That D.T. Cuenca school is there. That R.K. Manglam school is over there. Okay, that it has a very good reputation. Everywhere we are seeing technology. Because of technology, we are here. We are able to connect from distance schools or distance places.
Yes, it's convenient. It has a far-reaching impact. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
And, you know, it's the future.
It's the future, ma'am, for sure. We are looking after our school for so many students, thousands of students. When we are coming back at our home and we are talking to our kids, they are telling us what has to be done, what has not to be done about technology. My son tells me that how the posters had to be made, how the editing has to be done, or you get it done like this. This is not right. This is wrong. Okay, I'll do this for you. He's in grade 8 right now and he knows everything. We learn from them. We teach in the school to all the students, all the staff. When we come back to home, we learn from them also. That's there, ma'am. And technology is the future. It's the present, ma'am. It's present as well as the present. Future also.
Yes, thank present you, thank and you. The future. Yes.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. Coming up to Mayank. Mayank, again, we will like to know in precise about easy schooling. How it is that we should rely on you or on your easy schooling, or what is this easy schooling? Is it only for the admissions, or it provides certain other benefits also?
Okay. So first of all, before explaining about easy schooling, what I believe is word of mouth marketing is the best thing that any school should get. And secondly, what has happened with COVID? So like Yashika ma'am, Neha ma'am, and Anuradha ma'am, everybody so rightly said that all the initiatives that you guys are taking, that needs to reach out to the parents that are over there. Because what has happened in this digital world is everybody is so disconnected. Everybody is into their gadgets, like they are not able to talk to each other. So everything is so disconnected that even if a parent needs to decide ki agle 15 saal uska bachcha kahan padhna hai, कहाँ उससे उसका फ्यूचर शेप होगा एंड उसकी फैमिली एस्पिरेशंस क्या है, अगला 15 साल उसे करना क्या है, व्हाट इज द बजट दे हैव, व्हाट दे वांट टू डू, दे डोंट नो. सो व्हाटएवर अ प्रिंसिपल लीडर और अ मैनेजर ऑफ अ स्कूल इज डूइंग फॉर देयर स्कूल, व्हाट आर द स्कूल इनिशिएटिव दे आर टेकिंग, दैट नीड्स टू रीच आउट टू द पेरेंट्स. सो दैट्स समथिंग दैट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड दैट्स समथिंग दैट वी नीड टू एजुकेट parents in the digital age. So before that you used to rely on those billboard ads, newspaper ads and all those things, but now I think instead of advertisement it's more like word of mouth plus digital word of mouth. So we should focus on improving the happiness rate for the existing parents. If they are happy they will tell ki ye wala school acha hai, yahan pe admission ho. But still I feel that we need to get these initiatives, these USP to all the parents out there. So I was talking to a parent. So now अब क्या trend हो गया, जैसे मैं real estate की बात कर रही थी, अब ये trend हो गया कि लोग पहले school choose करते हैं, उसके बाद they decide for home. So the trends are changing. So school has taken the foreseat. Everybody is looking after. So whenever a parent is transferring from Bangalore to Noida or Gurgaon or Ghaziabad, they first choose school and then they decide कि मेरे को घर कहाँ पे लेना है, कौन सी society में लेना है, कैसे लेना है. तो जितने भी पेरेंट्स से मैं बात करता हूँ, आई हैव रियलाइज्ड दिस थिंग. सो वी नीड टू बी डिजिटली प्रेजेंट विद ऑल द यूएसपीज, इनिशिएटिव्स, थिंग्स दैट वी आर डूइंग फॉर पेरेंट्स, एडुकेटेड एंड मेकिंग देम अवेयर अबाउट आर थिंग्स टू द पेरेंट्स. सो दैट दीज चैलेंजेस दैट वी हैव ओवरकम, इफ वी टेल दीज स्टोरीज टू द पेरेंट्स, एंड आई थिंक इट कैन हेल्प देम टू एक्चुअली ट्रस्ट स्कूल्स एंड दे विल नॉट, दे विल इजीली पे फीस फॉर द स्कूल्स. सो दैट्स समथिंग दैट वी कैन डू.
There are expectations of the parents also, because you told me that after the session on Saturdays, even on 7 o'clock, you have sessions with the parents. And I, of course, whatever we are talking in the session, you are taking the outcomes of that to the parents, so that a better understanding should be between the parents. Of course, again the purpose of bringing over here one more is that he is bridging up the gap between the principals, the schools, and the parents also. He takes up session with the parents and he tells what type of problems the schools do face and how what they want and exactly cannot happen what they want. Mere bachche ko aisa kar dijiye, mere bachche ko waisa kar dijiye. We have to look after all that. So you might be facing so many different type of situation with the parents, their needs, their wants, and you might be tackling with them and according to the, you know, the level, what type of fees they want, what type of infrastructure they want, what type of facilities they want, you might be guiding them.
Absolutely. एक पेरेंट ने तो मुझे आके बोला, सर मेरे को एक ऐसा स्कूल बता दो जिसमें मैं बच्चे को एडमिट कराऊं तो मेरा आईआईटी में हो जाए. मैंने कहा ऐसी कोई मशीन नहीं बनी हुई कि हम आपको एक स्कूल में करा देंगे और आप आईआईटी में आ जाएगा आपका बच्चा. और वो कितनी गलत एस्पिरेशन है बच्चों से कि आप सीधा उससे आईआईटी, मतलब 21st सेंचुरी में भी पेरेंट्स आर थिंकिंग अबाउट दिस. सो दिस नीड टू चेंज एक्चुअली.
Right. When they see now that Sharma ji's son has become an engineer and he is working in Bangalore or US, so my son also should become the same and he should go to the same school and so to the same college. Even the scenario has changed then. That concept has to be changed of the parents for sure. And I hope you will be moving all our points to the parents also, that this is the right thing. Thank you. We'll come up to the second round of the session and we have to make it very quick, 2 minutes each answer. And rather, ma'am, I'll come up to you. There are certain parents in every school who are a problem creator. They have so many problems. They become a neta type of thing. They make a WhatsApp group and they pass on messages and they also make other people poke up that they should also go against the schools. So what do you have, your views, or what do you want to say to these type of parents which should reach to them?
So social media and WhatsApp, on one hand, it has made our life better in terms of making those connections. But, you know, so I did this workshop in my school, which we called as Swayam Se Vayam, in which we were talking of the stages of mind. So there is this stage of mind, which is called collective conscious mind, you know, CCM, which is about, if you have a strong CCM, then you will make positive connections and you will not get easily influenced by negativity. But unfortunately, there are a lot of people who do not have a strong or a positive CCM. They tend to carry negative CCM, which is more about getting impacted by the negative behavior, group behavior, you know, and that's exhibited everywhere. I'm sure we all know. So I think the only thing that one can do is to try and kind of, see, one is that when you know what you're doing is right and you are standing by the right and you are protecting the interest and of the children, you are standing by that, your focal point, your centroid is the student. You just have to carry on with your goodness and your good efforts. And sooner or later, the realization does come the way of the parent. We've seen these groups growing big with time and then contracting with time because the parents who were wrongly influenced, you know. So you as a school, you know, or as a principal of the school or as an educator, what I really want to say to the parents is that when you have a problem with the school or any issue which is not getting addressed, reach out to the school and find a solution, because the solution always lies where there is a problem. So if you have a problem with something, an issue in school, somebody from outside is not going to help you. And also when you consider your school, when you've chosen a school for your child to be there for, you know, good 14 years. So you have to make sure that your child takes pride in the education being provided, because then only the best benefit will go to the child. And absolutely. When you considering yourself to be part of that school family and culture, then you should behave like a member of the family. You know, if I have a problem with my child or my daughter, I am not going to go and write it on the notice board of my society that this is the problem. I'm going to go and sort it out, because, you know, there is that dignity, there is that positivity, there is that interaction that we have to have with each other and not spoil that relationship forever.
For sure, ma'am.
Parents need to value that. That's all.
So that is why we say to the parents that don't come up with complaints, come up with suggestions. If the suggestions are genuine, of course, we'll take action for that.
Absolutely.
For sure, ma'am. Yashika, ma'am, will you also, you might be also facing this in Ghaziabad with your school also, that there might be certain parents who are a problem. That might be very less, but there are few. How do you deal with them?
In fact, Mrs. Sarabjit, we've got three other principals here from Ghaziabad, and they'll vouch that in our state, the level of dissatisfaction of parents, although it was for a totally different reason, was tremendously high. But as I put to you, the reason for dissatisfaction of a parent with a school, and if you're concentrating on the fact that this is just related to COVID times or even otherwise, a parent is giving a child to you to nurture and to bring up. And the school and the parent, we are both are riding a tandem bicycle. Our focus and our aim is the same. And if one starts pedaling in disharmony with the other, we are not going to get anywhere. Now, in a time frame of 24 hours, if you do a calculated study, you will find that a parent is actually spending quality time with their children in parenting for only 3 hours in a day, whereas a teacher is spending almost up to 8 hours in a day with the child. So sometimes, as Mayank was saying, the parents are not aware. And as you mentioned, that parents are still focused that I need my child to become an engineer. I need my child to become a doctor, because parents don't know. And when they don't know about the options available, they don't know how to be a margdarshak. They don't know how to guide their children. When they don't know, that frustration comes out as well. Now, there is no problem in the world that cannot be solved by talk. The biggest of problems internationally have been solved by a roundtable discussion with all parties involved. When parents are dissatisfied, if there is a gentleman or a lady who's working in a company and is coming to your school demanding to meet the principal, now one we can do is we can sit in our hoity-toity ivory towers and say, take an appointment. But just think, something has made that parent leave his or her work, come to school and request to meet you. It is your duty to find some time. There is no parent who's so unreasonable who says, "Main aaya hu, toh mujhe abhi ke abhi milo." If you tell them, "I'm in the middle of a meeting, you need to wait for 20 minutes, they do wait. Hear them out. And a complaint is more often than not unreasonable. There's no smoke without fire. And we need to find out where that fire is that is irking somebody. And we need to resolve it. And the resolution comes about when you sit and you talk to the parent. And when you've heard the parent, If it is related to a teacher, if it is related to the school system, you are in a very positive position to be able to hear out both parties independent of each other and resolve the matter there itself. In our state, as I mentioned earlier, we have a system of a composite fee. And the entire country faced this problem about parents being dissatisfied about paying fee. But once again, how do you resolve it? As Anuradha said, if you're part of the family, you don't go out and start advertising that this is what's wrong with my family. Let the parents come in. If you in your heart are right, there is no way you will hesitate from meeting the parents. And if you can make them see your perspective or point of view, your battle is completely solved. But you must remember that while in this world, you can satisfy some of the people 100% all of the time, you can't satisfy 100% of the people 100% of the time. There will be those who are fence sitters, and there will be those who prefer to sit on the other side of the fence. But you have to take all of them together, and you have to be able to convince them that the entire system exists to uplift the child. And once you can get that into their minds and you can work as a team, then that tandem bicycle is going no place except the target where it was headed.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. You are really right, because if we, if they also take us as a family and they sit together, and we can resolve the problem, because the parent is not always there without any problem. There might be some problem, maybe lesser or more. There might be a confusion also. Many a times it happens, it is a confusion or a misunderstanding also. Right. Thank you so much, ma'am. Neha, ma'am, I'll come up to you now. All the time we say, or till now we are saying that the school has a lot of expectations from the, parents have a lot of expectations from the schools. Again, at the very opposite, the other side, schools also have some expectations from the parents and from the all the stakeholders. Please address to the people that what type of expectations do schools have from the parents?
Well, I think I'll just say we request only for 2 hours, not even, three. Respect and responsibility. So please respect the teacher who is putting in all hard work, all efforts to give shape to the future of your child, and take joint responsibility in the same. You know, if we talk about these COVID times, that boundary between the school and the home got really blurred. Parents became teachers and teachers became parents. So I'm sure when they have stepped in the shoes of the teachers, they would have realized that it's actually not so easy. So now, once you have realized it, kindly accept it and make sure that, you know, whatever you do is not something that makes the teacher feel that, why am I putting in all this effort? Make them feel a little respected. Make them feel that, yes, whatever efforts they're putting in. And take my word, I'm yet to come across a teacher who is not true to her profession. They might have taken it up as a second choice or a third choice, or maybe something very forcefully, and they have taken this up as a profession. But once they are a teacher, that thing kind of grows in them. And please respect them for who they are and what they are doing. So that is the only request, rather, not even an expectation. It's a request. And take my word, if we come together, again, the family thing, if we come together as a family and if we both come on the same side of the fence, for sure we are going to help our children much better than you are the school and I'm the parent mode. So
that's great, ma'am. And you're absolutely right. In first year, they all quibbled that my children, you don't do this, you don't do that, you don't do that. Now, when the children were there at home for the online classes, how it was becoming difficult for them to keep their one or two children to sit on the device and take the classes. And here the teachers takes up 30 to 40 kids in one class. Parents get fed up with 2 kids at home. and the teachers have to carry 30 to 40 students in the class, and they have to teach everything to them, because the response has to be given by the students also. Otherwise, the parents will sit at the head and say, what have you taught in the classes? My child is not knowing anything. Absolutely right, ma'am, because the parents sat with the kids and they watched that how difficult it is to manage the students. Because here we were saying that you have to manage your kid at your home. You should see that your child is attending the classes. We cannot come at your home. When physically offline, you were sending your kids to the school. We were handling everything. It was not your responsibility. Only responsibility of yours was to send them to the school. But now, because of online classes, if they are sitting over there with you, your responsibility is that they have to sit on the device and you should check out that they are taking up the classes. So first year, I know everybody will agree with me that the first year there was a quibbling with the parents also. This is right. This is wrong. This is also not happening. That is not happening. But second year, everybody was in rest. So I find the school and the school teachers, they are all right, because it is very difficult to manage the online classes and everything. We told them it was very easy. I also even had words with so many parents that you are not satisfied with online classes. But talking about school, your child was coming for 6 hours to the schools and the teachers were free by within 7 hours. Now the teacher has to work 24/7. So here the responsibility has increased. You take it out. 1.5 years, everything was closed. But a child education was not closed. It was through the government orders that children cannot come because their safety is more important. But at the very same time, less or more, the education went out of your child. So they didn't understand. They took time. The whole Pan India, I had discussion with so many people. First year, they cribbed. But second year now, they said, no, absolutely, the schools are right. And the school management or the school administrators are right. Thank you, Neha, ma'am, for your views. Another ma'am, I'll come up to you. Would you like to add into this that what are the expectations of a school from the society or the parents?
I think what Neha ma'am said, I'll just take it from there, that coming together is a beginning, keeping together is a progress, and working together is a success. So this defines the type of dynamic that should be shared between the school and the parents. We know that both are working towards achieving the same goal as making their children into successful human beings. So it is well known that Indian parents are very high, they have very high expectations that they want, that apart from being safe havens for their ward, the school should be into more and more activities and all. They have to be more in sync with the school, and they have to keep a check on the internet usage and make sure that child participates in activities organized by the school and switch on the cameras in the class. That is, every teacher is complaining for that. And schooling may be limited, but we know that education and learning is a lifelong journey. Since the child spends nearly 3/4 of the time at home with the family, they learn much more from the family, though interaction with parents and relatives. So this is therefore important to create a culture of learning where parents themselves are active in learning by their own reading habits. We also expect parents, never compare your child with another. Such comparisons, if repeated, demonstrates your child with and develops inferiority complex. And the other thing is that you have to be the person you want the child to be. Respect your child the way you want him to respect you. And you should show some positive behavior and attitude and empathize your child's emotions. And I know that most of us already know that importance of communication. So parents should talk to the child and also listen to him carefully for better relationship. And child will come to you when there is a problem. So don't have to provide the solutions, because parents are ready to give so many solutions to the child. But I think they should wait, and they should don't need to have all the answers to be a good parent. Just listen to him for better alternatives. And one of the biggest responsibility of a parent is to have confidence in their children. This can be achieved if they encourage and motivate their children's strength and good qualities.
What I feel, ma'am, that in one line we can say, if the parents are giving time to their kids,
all the
problems can be solved.
If
the problem is only there where the parents are not giving time to the kids, they are only feeling that we have deposited the fees, the whole of the responsibilities of the school. The problem is with these type of parents. So all the confidence of the parents with the child and the child confidence that I don't have to do anything wrong because what my parents will say. So that confidence building between the parent and the child is more important. It's also a plea to the parents that they should give time. Even their working parents, their business, doing business or anything, that is more important.
And I think they should stop criticizing schools and teachers.
No, ma'am, they have stopped now. In the first year, they did a lot of that. Yeah. But slowly and gradually, they understood that how the schools are managing all the things. It's so difficult, ma'am. They can't manage their kids, two kids at home. Yeah. We are managing thousands of students. Either it is offline or online. They have come to realize now gradually. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Chandok, I would like to add here that, you know, when children have used to come to school in the physical format, as we say, is the, you know, on-campus classes, the teachers have a bonding with the children and they would take care of the emotional health of the children. Now, the past 2 years have been so stressful and, you know, the children have been carrying the stress from their houses. Now, the only expectation that I have from parents is that they give, you know, some weightage to the emotional health of the child. You know, when I talk to parents at PTMs, I just tell them, please take care of our children while they are at home. So it's like that. When the children are with
absolutely
us at school,
right,
you know, we can take care of their emotional well-being. But since they are at home, this is one expectation from the parents. For the time that the children are at home, they should take care of their emotional health.
Absolutely right, ma'am. Absolutely right. The next question is also to you, Hardeep, ma'am, and a 1 minute answer I'll be leading. In the year 2021, we have come to know that technology has changed. There's a lot of transformation of education and it has moved from manual to the machine. Do you agree?
Definitely. You know, technology has transformed education. Now even in the rural areas, some state governments, they have collaborated with All India Radio, Doordarshan, and we have, you know, Tata Trust, Khan Academy. They've all come up with, you know, Pratham and other opportunities for the people in the rural areas, so the children in the rural areas to get equal opportunities. So that's one thing. I think that's a very good step to bring equality of education in the rural area. So here, technology has played a major role. The second thing is the availability of educational opportunities online. You know, there are online tools to enhance the learning experience and these are all free, right? So the classroom, the children can learn from these and the classroom can become a forum for debate, discussion and deeper delving into disciplines and to promote collaboration and experiential learning. So here comes the role information can be taken from online sources, from technology, and discussion on it can be taken in the classroom. So, that can help give more to our children in lesser time.
That's great, ma'am.
Yeah, the third thing could be personalized learning. You know, each child learns at his own pace. So with online tools, children can pace their learning and they can go over it again and again. So what I feel that technology can make education equitable, convenient, lifelong accessible. You know, even during this pandemic, not only children but elders also rolled on to online classes, workshops, and they all learned a lot. So technology has been educating not only children but to elders as well.
So what I believe what you want to say, Ardeep ma'am, is that after this pandemic, post-pandemic also, the offline and online, the mixed blend will be there. It will not like that offline class will go, the online classes altogether will go. There will be a mixed blend that 4 days or 5 days, the classes will be offline and 1 day it will be online. Your all the material will be sent to the Google Classroom or it will be sent to your, in your apps and all. That is for sure. So technology, so we can conclude that if technology is being brought forward for good cause to help the education, then it is the best way. Coming up to Mayank, we will conclude the session with your comment. How do you prove that your easy schooling is a very good one? It can help the schools. We come up with so many people coming to the company, people coming to our offices, out of the offices, and they are sending their visiting card. And we are saying them that, no, we don't have time right now. Of course, we don't have time. There are maximum people, they are coming up with the same material. How do you prove that they are, you are different and you are genuine? We want to know that. You're muted.
So like everyone said, we need to create a family to work together. We need to work together to make it a success. So I will take these words from you all. And I think jab parents or schools saath mein kaam karenge and saath mein milke bachche ki growth pe kaam karenge. So I think then the future of our country will be brighter. And this is the vision with which I am working. I am just a bridge, which is like bridging the parents. So हमने एक session करा था, second wave of COVID के आसपास हमने एक campaign करा था, hashtag don't stop schooling. So 20 Swiggy orders are equivalent to your school fees. And like all the egg number of activities that you're doing for recreational are equivalent to your monthly school fees. And you're not paying school fees with which your future will be decided. So एक ये चीज़ करी थी and Hardeep ma'am की बहुत अच्छी बात लगी मुझे जो उन्होंने बोला कि holistic development. So I think जो आजकल के schools हैं, I am really impressed by visiting schools of Delhi NCR. They are focusing on holistic development of a kid. So parent has an equal role to play over there. So that is something that we need to impart. And Easy Schooling is doing something similar. They are just telling parents कि Red Rose Public School में या GD Goenkam या KR Mangalam में ये सारी चीजें होती हैं. इसकी वजह से होता है. You need to cooperate to the school and you both need to work together to get your child into a good place. I would not say IIT. I would say to being a skilled person who can live his life or her life with dignity and earn something good for her and his family. So this is something that we are, that is the vision of we what we are doing. So creating a family together.
That's great, man. You're doing a commendable job. And at a very small age, you have started up with this. We wish you all the best for your project. And hopefully we'll see. We want to see after 4-5 years that you reach Pan India with your project, because it is very helpful too. Because the main thing is you are connecting the schools with the parents. That is the most important thing. Parents do not come want to connect directly with the schools. They don't understand the feelings or the, you know, situation of the school. That's what you are doing. Thank you so much. That's the end of the session. Thank you so much, everyone, for sparing your time for this session. We are very grateful to you, and Radha Mehta ma'am. Mayank, Yashika Bharatwaj ma'am, Anuradha Anta ma'am, Atit ma'am, Neha Sharma ma'am, we learned a lot from you. The sharing of the ideas was very good, and hopefully we will meet again in some other session.